Thank you very much. Good morning to all of you. Honorable Justice Geeta Mittal, Professor Ranveer Singh, Vice Chancellor, Law University, National Law University, Dr. Rajesh Suri, President, Institute of Chartered Management Association, eminent faculty members, panelists, participants, students. For me, it's I believe a lifetime experience, because I'm not a lawyer, and I don't think so, otherwise I would have had the opportunity of actually even talking to you or having an interface dialogue with any one of you here in the National Law University. So I think it's a privilege on my part. Thank you really very much for all of you, for especially the National Law University, for taking this initiative, because this issue is indeed a very, very important issue in the light of today's discussions and deliberations in this country, especially when we are talking about women empowerment in every aspect. For me, very honestly, I am at all no expert in this subject. So whatever I'm going to speak is actually a learning process for me myself. But yes, the experience that I gain, we gain at National Commission for Women, the kind of issues that are being raised every day, day by day, the kind of problems that the women come to us with, they are so diverse in nature. But at the same time, I'm really sorry to say that I don't think so any complainant has ever walked in, any woman has ever walked in NCW, to the best of my memory, who has complained about any issue which is related to surrogacy, which is indeed a very sorry state of affair. That means yet, I mean, such women do not even know that there is a system, there is a mechanism where they can go and they can really talk about their problems or try to find out the solutions. I especially want to request and assure you, Professor Ranveer Singh, because you have said that National Commission for Women had been associated with your good self in the past, and I would really take this opportunity to request you and also assure you that NCW is definitely going to have more interactions with your good self and your institution of esteem, so that we do more in terms of delivering to the women of this country. Very honestly, what is surrogacy? That is, I think to me it was something very, very important. What is surrogacy and why surrogacy? The most important question as a woman that actually came to my mind, why surrogacy? Why at all do we need surrogacy? I know all of you are immensely educated, you know the subject very well, but still as a layman, I personally felt that it is very important to flag the issue as to why surrogacy is important and why it is needed. Well, there are certain points that come to my mind. One is definitely infertility. The other is removal of uterus. In the medical language, we call it as hysterectomy. I'm sorry, I'm not able to pronounce that word properly. Then the age factor is definitely there, which I came across by browsing. Cancer and other such very serious ailments are certainly one of the reasons. Then sometimes same-sex couples, which is not very, very much prevalent in India, but yes, I mean, that is also one issue. And single parenting is also another issue which is very important, and that is why perhaps we need surrogacy in this country or in this world. Now, India's effort to promote medical tourism took off in the late 2002 when the Confederation of Indian Industry produced a study on the country's medical tourism sector in collaboration with Indian management consultants, which outlined immense potential for the sector. The following year, the then finance minister called for the country to become a global health destination. The reproductive segment of the market in India is estimated to be worth more than 4,000 million pounds. So this is something which is very, very, I think, alarming, because we know that India is a huge market, and that is why perhaps we see so many issues which are definitely going to be pondered about, because there are so many women whose interest is at stake. Now, apart from all the ethical issues that has been raised by Honorable Justice Geeta Mittal, I would like first to talk about what NCW has been doing about it, and then I would like to raise some more points and then maybe wind it off. Now, as far as NCW's initiatives are concerned, National Consultation on Surrogacy and Assisted Reproductive Technologies was on this particular issue was that National Commission for Women expressed concern over various shortcomings in guidelines for accreditation, supervision and regulation of assisted reproductive technology clinics in India 2005. NCW raised the issues in a national consultation on surrogacy and assisted reproductive technologies in the year 2008. NCW forwarded the resolution taken at the national consultation to Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Then NCW forwarded the resolution taken at the national consultation and recommended for a legal framework specifying the rights of surrogate mothers, surrogate child and commissioning parents. Because as very rightly pointed out previously by eminent speakers, that it is not just the right of the woman, it is also the right of the child which has to be looked into. NCW recommended legal framework which should adequately address the impact of this procedure on physical, mental and well-being of the surrogate mother. So there was a research which was taken by NCW in collaboration, and there were a couple of recommendations which had emerged after that. But at present, I would like to tell you that the present status of this particular bill is that there has been a question about what should be the amount of compensation, the monetary aspect of it. And at present, actually, there is, I can put across a comparative statement of views of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, FOCSI and members of the Commission on the specific issues of developing a formula for minimum compensation. Now, what should be the compensation? That is one question which was raised. Now, suggestions which emerged in the committee constituted by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, this is the latest, possible formulas to calculate as per the Workmen Compensation Act based on age. This is one aspect that they are looking at. Railway accident and untoward incidences rule 1990, that is 6 lakhs. Then they are talking about as per compensation paid in clinical trials. Then another option is minimum compensation should not be less than 20 times the per capita income. This is their views. Now they opened this discussion and they have asked even National Commission for Women to give their views upon this. Suggestions of FOCSI are, there are again two, three points that they have raised. Presently, compensation to surrogate mother ranges from rupees 2.5 to 3.5 lakhs. A formula of minimum salary for an unskilled worker per month into 9 months into 5, which is a compensation of rupees 3.64 lakh, should be adopted. And this is, if you look at these figures, it is, I mean, I'm really surprised as to what kind of sensitivity is actually to this entire issue. Now, suggestions which are still under consideration by members of NCW. One, it is again of different members of National Commission for Women, which are still being formulated. Figures cannot be conjured without knowing the present practice. That means we need to know what is the present practice across the world. A short consultation of at least 15 to 20 people to actually just deliberate on this issue. Then minimum, another member says that minimum compensation as suggested in the meeting is based on detailed study and there is no reason to differ and suggest new ideas. Then another aspect is that financial and social background of surrogate mother and infertile couple needs to be given due consideration. Then the concept of specifying and defining the quantum of compensation for a surrogate mother seems inappropriate. The amount would be settled directly between contracting parties. The concept of multiple of the minimum wage sounds incorrect as the pregnancy is not something related to manual labor. This is some of the views which have been actually discussed in within the National Commission for Women. Now coming back to the topic, and there are a couple of questions, couple of suggestions which I really wanted to talk about. The entire idea of a child created in a test tube and carried by an unrelated woman is enough to drive fear into the hearts of many while questioning the ethics of surrogacy. Commercial surrogacy has been legal in India since 2002. In India, it is much simpler and less costly. Commercial surrogacy as an Indian culture, if you really talk about, surrogate mothers face high levels of social stigma. That is one very, very important thing which we need to really understand and be sensitized about. Surrogate mothers treated as disposables, because poverty is a very, very big issue which leads to women getting into this thing. Associate surrogacy with paid sex workers. This comparison to prostitution further stigmatizes the surrogate women. This is again another aspect of it which is which we really need to ponder upon. And there are some more questions. One is how much or whether the woman to be paid for being surrogate, for how much, as I talked about, because there's a huge discussion and still we are not able to come out, because a woman is not just lending her womb. It's a lot. A lot more has to be done with her emotions, with the psychological aspect of it, and the entire life is just not a time period of 9 months which needs to be looked into. Then can the rights of women and children be bartered? This is also one thing which I think need to be questioned. Now, if the arrangements fall foul, then will it amount to some kind of a relief to the woman who was actually into the contract? There are certain suggestions which I really wish to make. One is that legal circumstances, partnering local organizations and lawyers to provide a complete solution for successful handling of surrogacy with international partners, because especially international parents, when they come inside to this country in the name of medical tourism, then it's a very complex and a complicated issue, and we really need to think about it. Now, well-defined regulations to the entire to ensure that full legal rights for both parents and the newborn. It's not just the mother aspect, the surrogate mother. It is also we need to talk about the parents as well as the child, which is very, very important. The new legislations to ensure positive sign of legislation of commercial surrogacy and try to change the conservative approach of the society. And that can be done, I believe, through awareness, because this is one thing which we need to actually shortlist and identify the states where this industry is really, really rampant, and then we need to make sure that we sensitize the people, we make them aware. Right to termination of pregnancy for the surrogate mother is in case of a medical emergency or physical or mental trauma. This is also one aspect which has to be flagged. Now, provision of a minimum time period up to which the surrogate mother should be allowed to nurse the child. Because should it be just right after the birth or 3 months or what? Because even the medical, the health aspect of the child, the newborn baby, is also at stake. So that is one thing which we really need to think about. And with this and lot many other ethical issues which have been raised by Honorable Justice Geeta Mittal, I think I'm sure that 2 days deliberations will really come out with some very good recommendations and will help National Commission for Women to give our viewpoint on this very important issue. Once again, I thank each one of you for becoming a part of this very important deliberation, and I thank the chair, the panel. Thank you really very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Shamila Shafiq, for your enlightening address and giving us an insight into the thinking of NCW. With this, I request our registrar, Professor G.S. Vajpayee, for a vote of thanks. Professor Vajpayee is a researcher who has interest in the field of human rights and criminology, and he has been working constantly for making this conference a reality, and certainly his inputs are going to benefit us all.
Many thanks to you, and before I do the honor of extending vote of thanks, I'm tempted in fact to make a couple of remarks, as I find the subject is quite engaging from the viewpoint of several perspectives, because this is one subject which, according to me, can be approached from several viewpoints. If a person who is interested in family law, in gender studies, human rights, constitutional law, so I find this subject takes shape according to the perspective that you deal with it. You know, I also feel that a very broad and very relevant canvas has already been drawn by 2 very eminent professionals who have flagged the issues which are going to be deliberated and taken up in the discussions to be held in the next 2 days. I find the idea of surrogacy was always very great, and it is like any other idea that you have. The ideas are generally very great. The problem becomes when they are practiced, and the same happened with surrogacy. And I think for a country like India, we need to really look at and look into rather whether we as a nation are prepared to regulate a very sensitive issue like surrogacy, because the experiences abroad have been very different. In many countries, especially in European countries, they also have started like us. They have started in the beginning to regulate the practice of surrogacy, because the idea was found to be very relevant in terms of responding to the problem of infertility. But later on it was found to have been causing a lot of issues which are ethical, legal, social, psychological, and a lot of adversities have been noted. And therefore in so many countries they have made it illegal. You know, that has been the journey. So for a country like, we have to look at whether Indian state is really prepared to regulate this important practice. Because I also feel that in India, several social health issues have been legalized and laws have been passed. But the experience of enforcing the social legislation has not been very, very increasing in this country. Because we know we have got a society which is conservative and traditional on the one hand and progressive and modern on the other hand. And this caused a lot of legal pluralism, and which is very difficult to be responded to by the courts, because our social expectations at times become quite contrary to legal norms. So legal formalism and social expectation coming into clash become a huge issue. And this has been the experience in terms of, you know, thinking of regulating this particular practice. I have had a series of discussion with Deeksha, who is researching the subject, and whatever understanding I could acquire through those discussion and the studies which have been conducted, and what we gather that there are several issues which Honorable Justice Geeta Mittal has pointed out rightly, that you have to look at the three models that the surrogacy has. The surrogacy as in itself, the commercial surrogacy, altruistic surrogacy. I don't know whether altruistic surrogacy exists in true sense or not. It is mostly the commercial surrogacy we are talking about, and we are intending to regulate that commercial surrogacy. But the fallouts are quite, you know, discouraging in the beginning, because in India those problems have already started happening in many places. So what I find, a lot of criminalization of surrogacy has started. Now these issues are those which have a kind of potential to negate the very noble idea of surrogacy, which could have been otherwise very beneficial to the society. Now, how the law and policy would balance the, because the fallout should not take over the benefits of the, you know, institution of surrogacy. If that happens, then the real problem arises. Several issues have been raised, and I'm sure those would be that, especially the commissioning couple, intended couples, the contractual issues, the issues relating to the surrogate mothers, and even we discuss the manner in which the contracts are reached, contracts are implemented, and what are the stakes for the surrogate mother, stakes for the commissioning couple. So a lot of legal and ethical dilemmas are going to be there. Now, do we have a very consistent and solid policy to handle it? Because after 2002 Japanese baby case, some guidelines have been evolved, and the bill is also on the annual. So I think a lot of discourse, and I find we generally do not engage in sufficient pre-legislative discussion on these subjects in several forums. Before bringing the law, I think the issues which have tremendous social bearing required to be taken to the people for whose benefit or for whom it is going to be finally applied. So this process is not only applicable to this particular issue, but it equally applies to all those issues which are having a lot of social bearing, which are having immense social impact. So therefore, in terms of pre-legislative impact studies and post-legislative impact studies, this kind of, because we have seen the fate of 498A, the spirit with which it was implemented, now we are backtracking. The Law Commission has already recommended to make it, you know, compoundable and available. So the original idea has really lost, and the spirit with which it was intended is no longer there. So I think a lot of care needs to be exercised, and here the role of fundamental and empirical research comes, because when Deeksha was researching, I advised her that instead of doing a kind of table work, we need to go to the people to whom this is happening. And the insights which she has gathered from the field, and she shared me a lot, I think our entire focus has changed as far as this is concerned. So So I think a lot of empirical research is needed in those issues, which would ultimately take us to, you know, improvise and shape the policy lines pertaining to this particular aspect. And these are a couple of things. I am quite excited and looking forward to the outcome of this discussion, as the papers and the panelists, they have brought significantly important subjects and papers, and I'm sure these deliberations are going to be very, very pertinent. I take this opportunity to sincerely thank to Honorable Ms. Justice Geeta Mittal for having come and delivered very important talk. And I think she has done the job which was required to flag the issues. And I'm sure this discussion is bound to be revolving around those issues. And I'm finding that the issues raised by her are quite relevant to the paper presenters, because they have also picked up some of these issues in their respective paper. Ma'am, I'm thanking you a lot from the standpoint of the National University, on behalf of the National University. And she has been a moving spirit. And the students are a big fan of yours in that. Whenever I go, they have several requests to you, and you have been so kind and helpful to them. So we look forward to your consistent support and frequent arrival to this institute to encourage the faculty and the student here. I am equally thankful to Mrs. Shamina Safiq. She has raised very interesting and pertinent issues with her experience in the National Commission for Women. And I also request you to be a little more frequent to us, because we have a lot of focus on gender studies and women issues in our university. And I also profusely thank Dr. Radesh Suri, the President of the Institute of Chartered Management. In fact, he has been coming last more than 2-3 months and had a series of meetings with us, and he was quite keen to see that this interaction becomes really fruitful, and it is really happening like that. I'm so thankful to you for making this opportunity to faculty and the students here. And I have no words to really thank to our respected Vice Chancellor, Sir M.B. Singh, and there is a series of academic activities and research engagements because of his constant support and blessings to the faculty and to the researcher. Thank you so much for being with us and encouraging the whole spirit of this particular program. I also take this opportunity to thank the team who was instrumental in making it happen, Dr. Anju Dadi, Dr. Krishnanshu, and Diksha. Big thanks to all of you, and I'm sure that the deliberations emerging from this interaction will be immensely useful. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Professor Vajpayee. With this, we conclude this very meaningful inaugural session. This has been very stimulating, and I hope that you would follow up with equally stimulating sessions. We start with the first session, that is surrogacy as an industry, right away in room number 101. Our volunteers, student volunteers, would guide you. You just have to go out of this room, right, first floor, and the first room on the left side. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks to a very warm welcome to Honorable Justice Vidya-mitra, Judge Delhi High Court, and more than Paul Paras is the member of the General Council. Many of the facilities which you see on this campus, including this hall, the academic block, the landscape, the contribution of Justice Vidya-mitra is great. She has been advising us right from the beginning when we started this industry in 2008. And being a member of the General Council from that time and date, even before, she is a wonderful friend of the university, a great advisor. And for any difficulty we face in terms of students looking for any internship or for a research input or for our functions, she is one person in the High Court who never says no. We welcome you, Madam, on behalf of the entire NLU family. Dr. Samina Safiq, she said she is no doctor, but I'm not going to withdraw it.
because we have a tradition in universities, we say everybody professor and doctor. So it doesn't matter. Member of the National Commission Women, I was sharing with her that the National Schools very closely engaged with the Women Commissions for all their research projects, for their training programs. And since she is here, I've been going to the National Commission for a number of occasions. For a long time, I was the advisor to the Women Commission, and we believe that we engage more closely with you and do a lot of research work for you. We have a very, very young and bright faculty, those who are doing the state-of-the-art research work in the country for different ministries, different commissions, bodies. So we would like to be very actively connected with you. We have Dr. Suri, and again, I don't know whether it's doctor or not, so excuse me if I say something wrong. And the president of the Indian Institute of Chartered Management Administration, they are very active partner for this program. So welcome you to this function. I welcome all the chairs, the panelists. I'm slightly allergic to mobile phone. Would you please switch off your mobile phones? Doctors told me, I don't know why. So please switch off your mobile phones. Is it okay? So I welcome all the chairs, the panelists, the participants from far and wide, and also welcome the students, the faculty, staff, and the university. My task will not be complete if I especially not welcome the star, Professor Vajpayee, who is sitting with me, Diksha, Munjal, and also Anju. She is of course doctor, both of them, and she is trying to be doctor. And Prashant Sudok. The entire program has been, and those students who are working with you, the entire the program has been put in place by them. Big hand for them. Though Diksha has given me a 3-4 page note to speak here, since people will be deliberating on surrogacy issues and we have a keynote speaker, I'm not going to leave that note. So, but I'd like to share a story with you. The story goes like this. This is one written by Jennifer Kirby. Some of you must have read it. And this is the heading of the story is, "These two Americans want babies through Indian surrogates. It has not been easy." The story is like this. In separate photos, the twins are wrinkled and pale. Both boys lie on a blue-green hospital sheet, one with limbs outstretched, the other curled up, and their faces are scrunched. Perhaps they are crying. The twins' father, Trevor, who is an American, flips back and forth between the two photos on the cell phone. At 53, he is married, has two daughters, 15 and 8, but he has restless energy for a first-timer father. Just looking at the pictures every night, I pray for them, I tell them good night, I kiss them and say, this looks like it is real. The photos are how Trevor knows his son exists. At this point, he doesn't met them yet because they were born in a surrogate mother in New Delhi, India, thousands of miles away from his home in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. When they were born on October 16th, 37 weeks, he hadn't booked the plane ticket yet. As it still hasn't felt real, Trevor said, "Not until I trust those babies, until I start hugging those babies, I feel they're mine." Trevor's strange limbo is certainly unusual for those who purpose surrogacy abroad, one kind of fertility tourism that's on the rise as singles and couples, both gay and straight, seek ways to overcome their limits, biological, financial, legal, technological, of having children for US residents. In particular, surrogacy costs are cheaper overseas by tens of thousands of dollars, especially in India. But there are trade-offs. The child is born in another country, a distance that's more than physical. It spans language and culture, and parents need paperwork, embassy appointments, and international flights to bring their baby home. And what a hassle it would be anybody's guess. Travis has been through this process herself. She married with 3 kids, a 5-year-old son, 3-year-old twins, all born through surrogacy in India. She is open and empathetic, but direct about difficulties and potential disparagements of Travis' decision. Surrogacy in India is never the first option, Travis says. It is people who have expended a lot of effort, money, energy, trying to get children the other ways. Now, these are the issues which in this seminar we'll be discussing. Surrogacy, of course, is a very complex and challenging subject which you are going to discuss. We don't have much literature, much research on the subject. But the key points would be, surrogacy is a form of reproductive technology and to realize the dreams of children. India and other countries need to evolve legislation. Now it is done all through conflict, I know. The exploitation of economically backward women is a big issue in these issues. Commercial surrogacy is a good alternative for both forthcoming parents and surrogate, so long as the contract is fair on both sides. But is it going to be fair? Is it a $1 million question? There is a need to increase public awareness on various aspects of surrogacy, but most of the people are uneducated and illiterate. What happens? The rights of both the unborn baby have to be addressed in detail. There is no clause in a proposed Indian bill which considers infringement of baby's right when he is deprived of or she is deprived of breast milk. The establishment of milk banks to overcome this problem should be seriously considered feasible. A good professional guidance can go a long way in preventing complications associated with these surveys. These are the issues I'm sure many of the scholars, those who have done research on this, are going to discuss. I do not want to take much time. Thank you very much, all of you, and welcome to Attitude Health.